There's a lot of challenges in developing longevity drugs for humans, predominantly time and money. But a lot of those challenges are not as severe in dogs. This is something that people more broadly really want too. I kind of thought it was a ridiculous idea for a while, but then I realized it wasn't.
Loyal is a San Francisco-based startup developing drugs to delay canine aging. The company, which is one of 25 on this year's Next Billion-Dollar Startups list, has a valuation of $425 million, and it may have its first beef-flavored longevity pill on the market in 2026.
I learned about the thesis of aging and aging therapeutics, basically this idea that you can develop drugs that target the mechanisms by which we deteriorate and age over time that lead to what we classically consider a disease today, but are precursors to the disease. And that's a way to kind of keep somebody healthy longer. And I was like, well, that just makes a lot of sense. Like we should do that. And I want to do that. We are working on a number of drugs to extend dog lifespan at Loyal. They tend to fall into two categories. One category is big dog, short lifespan. So trying to ameliorate the underlying genetic drivers of why we believe big dogs age faster and die sooner. And the other category is around metabolic decline, which is for dogs of any size or most sizes.
You can think of metabolism kind of like the engine of a car, right? It takes the fuel and turns it into energy and work and makes things happen. And as the car gets old, or as you or your dog get old, the engine gets gummed up, the oil gets dirty and sticky, and the spark plugs get all crusty, and it doesn't work as efficiently. And that leads to a decrease in energy and to all the diseases that we're used to seeing as people and dogs age. So the purpose of the drug is to keep the metabolism running in a healthier, more efficient way, to keep the engine clean and delay all of those negative health consequences that come with aging.
The broader thesis of the drugs that we've chosen and the mechanisms we have chosen is one, things that are extremely well validated across organisms, beyond dogs, right? So these mechanisms are mechanisms that have been shown to extend lifespan in worms and yeast and mice. This isn't something that's specific to dogs or specific to a breed of dog, but instead it's just foundational to how organisms have evolved to age and the ways in which they have evolved to age less healthily or more healthily. The kind of food you give your dog, the genetic luck that your dog has, how often you run with your dog or whatever has happened to them in their lives, that's gonna impact their individual aging trajectory. And so you really have to find a biological mechanism that will not be impacted by all that variability and instead is much more foundational and fundamental to how life works. And that's really what we've gone after.
Loyal is now running what may be the largest clinical trial ever conducted in animal health.
It's about 1,300 dogs across the US that are taking either a drug or a placebo, and it's blinded, so we don't know. The veterinarians don't know. Obviously, the dog owner doesn't know. I guess the dog doesn't know either if they're on the real drug or not. And we're going to be following these dogs for the next 4 to 5 years, you know, for the rest of their lives, to understand how did they age, what diseases do they get, what are they diagnosed with, you know, what levels in their blood go up or down over time, to then be able to distinctly quantify at the end, hopefully, a lifespan and health span benefit of the dogs who are treated with our drug over the placebo.
When we started the study, our goal was 1,000 patients, and people said, you're crazy, you'll never get 1,000 people to enroll in a study like this. And we've reached 1,300 because there's just an outpouring of enthusiasm. People are really excited about being part of the study because they hope that maybe the medication will help their dog, but also because they want to be part of helping us to develop something new that will help other people's dogs in the future.
We actually very intentionally are not doing centralized trials. We're doing decentralized trials. We want to capture the breadth of diversity that you have in the average dog, right? We don't want just one Silicon Valley, you know, super bougie dogs on $500 dog food. We don't just want, you know, pure breeds or just working dogs. We want the dog that sleeps on the couch all day and a dog that runs a marathon with its owner. We want the dog that's purebred. We want the mutt that somebody rescued from the shelter. And we are doing that in part by ensuring we have a huge geographic and socioeconomic diversity in the vet clinics that we've chosen, so that we're able to capture that variability and adequately assess the benefit of our longevity drugs on that diversity. And that's really important when you're looking at something like aging, because aging is extremely complicated and you need to be able to tease that out.
we're going to get an incredible goldmine of data about how dogs age, about the diseases they get, the causes of those things. And I think that's really going to advance the field of geriatrics in veterinary medicine. We're going to help other researchers and veterinarians to take better care of senior dogs, even beyond the drugs that we're developing. Part of the reason that I encounter skepticism when I talk to people about extending lifespan in dogs is that the field of longevity research is pretty well known, and unfortunately there's a lot of not very scientifically legitimate stuff being talked about out there. And it's sometimes hard to distinguish really good science from sort of fake science or marketing of new ideas that aren't really legitimate. There are always a few skeptics who say, well gosh, aging is not something we can do anything about, it's just sort of an inevitable part of the universe. But when we explain a little bit about how it works, and how we already know from research science that you can extend lifespan and delay all of the diseases of aging, then that skepticism often turns to excitement.
I think my non-canonical upbringing was crucial because I was exposed pretty young to the vulnerability that the average American and average person more broadly has to health and to health scares. I think, you know, now in the world that we're in, you know, here in Silicon Valley, people have concierge doctors and their employers pay for super platinum healthcare insurance. That wasn't how I was raised. And so it really made me respect and be cognizant of the lack of free will that we have from disease and sickness. And it solidified my desire to do something about it. When I started Loyal 5 years ago, most biotech people who I talked to, when I told them I wanted to get a drug FDA approved for lifespan extension, they were like, good luck. That is never gonna happen. That's not how it works. You know, naive little girl, like go have your first meeting and you'll see what happens to you, basically. And you know, they were wrong.
Loyal's 30-year-old CEO, Celine Halioua, is a scientist who loves animals.
My family are huge animal lovers, to the point that after it would rain, we'd walk around the block and pick up the snails so they wouldn't get run over by cars or stepped on by people on the sidewalk. We had 15 cats, 4 dogs, rescue squirrels, the whole thing. I wanted to be a veterinarian when I was a kid. I have a 10, 11, 12-ish year old Rottweiler named Della, who I adopted from a senior dog rescue called Muttville here in San Francisco. She is the light of my life. She is the sweetest sweetie pie.
She enrolled at the University of Texas at Austin as an art major, but soon found herself spending hours in the lab.
Pretty quickly after I started at UT Austin, I wanted to go work in a lab because I was really interested at the frontier of science, not just catching up on where the science is, but can we really find that the edge of the bubble and, you know, help start pushing it forward. I had always been very interested in seeing the inside of the body, MRIs, CAT scans, things like that that allow you to see the structure, especially the structure of the brain is something I've always been very interested in. And I decided to do a shadowing at a neuro-oncology clinic that was MRI-based. I met people who were being told by the physician I was shadowing that there was nothing that they could do and that they were gonna die.
That kind of prognosis didn't sit well with her.
Why aren't we working on preventing somebody from getting this disease, right? Why is the only amount of work on the end stage, or the majority on the end stage of the disease, and not the precursors of the disease that often develop decades before, which is the case for a lot of these age-related diseases?
So she turned to research.
There's many ways to help people. You can become a nurse, you can become a firefighter, you can become a doctor. But there was also this whole other world that I didn't really understand at the time, which was developing and translating new medicines, which wasn't necessarily most facilitated by being a doctor, or certainly being a doctor was not the only path by which to do that.
After undergrad, Celine went to Oxford to work on a PhD in the health economics of gene therapy.
Europe is well known for having these single-payer healthcare systems where they invest a lot in preventative care. And I thought it would be interesting to live in and work in an environment and work on medicines in an environment where that economic incentivization of the kind of medicines I was going to develop or wanted to develop existed. While I was at Oxford, I became pretty convicted in that, you know, the way I was going to have my impact on the world was developing drugs for aging, whether it was facilitating or developing them myself.
While still pursuing her PhD, Celine joined the Longevity Fund, a venture capital firm based in San Francisco, after reaching out to founder Laura Deming.
And I sent her a cold email and asked if I could shadow her for 2 weeks over winter break and learn a little bit more about what she was doing and learn a little bit more about this world where people, you know, invest in companies that have a 99% probability of failure with the hope of them becoming, you know, something that has a huge impact on the world. The first thing I learned is I'm not a very good venture capitalist. And I am not particularly interested in being a venture capitalist. But that's okay, because I did find out that I really like operating and I really like making things happen. And the insights that led to Loyal and to Dog Longevity, I never intended to start this company. It really kind of happened serendipitously. It came from a combination of, you know, all these companies would come pitch us at Longevity Fund, and I just didn't understand why nobody was developing an aging drug for aging and longevity. And so I became obsessed, and I worked for, you know, almost 2 years with Laura with how could you get the first drug FDA approved for lifespan extension.
I was trying to find someone who was working on dog cloning, and someone said, oh, you should go talk to Celine. She's, you know, a PhD student at Oxford and is super smart and doing a bunch of work. Maybe she knows something there. And I got connected. I met her. And in that very first meeting, she said, look, that's a cool idea. I know nothing about dog cloning, but like, now that you prompted me on dog cloning, I'm studying longevity. What about dog longevity? Like, if we can't clone the dog, you know, how about making the dog live longer?
When you say, oh, I want to develop a human longevity drug, there becomes a lot of questions, right? When you talk about dog longevity, everyone's like, oh, well, yeah, obviously dogs deserve to live a longer, healthier life. Obviously they should not get sick. And I thought it was a really nice way to introduce the thesis to the average person who may never have heard of it before or may only have negative connotations, and really show that the science is legitimate. Greg Rosen, he had been one of the early investors in Roe. And so he'd seen kind of this intersection of pharmaceuticals and consumer branding and what can happen when you have that direct relationship. And so he convinced me that it was a good idea from a company's perspective, and he convinced me that I could be a founder and a CEO.
It's like my job to meet early, you know, founders and people all day. There are certain people that you meet that just like jump off the page and sort of cut through the noise. And you're like, whoa, I don't even know what that was. That was exciting. That was exactly how I felt with Celine.
I think the most accurate description I've ever heard of building a company is like eating glass. And it really is like eating glass or like running towards the fire, right? Like every time there's a fire, there's no one else who's gonna put it out, especially in the early days.
Ultimately, there was nothing other than her to start and a dream and maybe like a little bit of data, but really it was a lot of narrative and storytelling to convince early investors who also really weren't scientists as well.
The seed was just me and a pitch deck. So it was really when I closed that seed round in January 2020 when we were off to the races, this thing existed in the real world, we had some money. The first years were really figuring out who we wanted to be when we grew up, right? We had this broad thesis, and I always set the expectation that the end goal was to get the first drug FDA approved for lifespan extension in dogs. And once I started hiring and building the team, we started iterating on that and led to some of the drugs that we have today, which I never would have come up in my wildest dreams, but were much more effective ways of getting at the biology and the core thesis of the company. And then also a lot of figuring out the complexities of developing a drug. It's not just like putting something in a pill and like calling it a day. It is, every aspect of it is extremely regulated and extremely difficult, and it takes an extremely long time. And if you want to do it in a period of time that's reasonable, you have to be on it. This ain't no software app.
We have a real commitment to doing the science well and effectively. You know, we've gone through the FDA approval process for our drugs rather than making, you know, a supplement or a diet, because it's a higher evidence bar. It's more work, it takes longer, but at the end of the day, you have something that you can have more confidence in that is truly safe and effective and works.
I wanted to show that we're not just developing a supplement with sexy marketing or whatever. Cool, great. I wanted to show that we could get a drug through one of the toughest and most well-respected regulatory bodies in the world, through the FDA, for lifespan extension. And to show that this is a legitimate, you know, field of science, just like anything else. And we could do that in dogs. We, you know, got the FDA to agree that a drug can be approved for lifespan extension, health span extension, the first time that's occurred, as far as we know, in any species. And then we followed up by getting the efficacy approval for twice now, for two of our drugs have earned a reasonable expectation of efficacy, which basically means that the agency has assessed our thousands of pages of data and believes it's reasonable to expect that these drugs are going to extend the healthy lifespan of a dog. It also means that we're getting closer and closer of bringing this to market. So we still need a few more FDA approvals. Again, every step is extremely regulated to be able to bring a drug to market, but we are closer than anybody else ever has been.
I always ask myself when I'm meeting someone and in hearing about their company, how can this be the most important company over the next decade? And I wasn't even connecting the dots that like a dog longevity business can actually potentially become the longevity business. And you only earn the right to do that through building a really big first act business. And that's like a classic example of Celine just like up-leveling sort of what I thought was an ambitious idea to something even better.
A lot of people don't get it. But for those who do, they get it so deeply in their soul and it matters so much to them personally. And yes, obviously investors want to make money and they have, you know, responsibilities to their investors. But people just care personally about this in a way that it is difficult to care as much about, you know, a B2B SaaS company or whatever it is. And I think that's really been a tailwind for us. Loyal has raised about $150 million to date. From excellent investors. And I think the reason we have been successful in raising capital is because we're building a future that people want fundamentally, and we're making progress on it. And we're making impressive progress on it, if I may say that. 5 years ago when I started this company, I think 90% of people passed. Most people didn't believe that we would get anywhere. Most people didn't believe that this was something that should be built. And so I don't take for granted the fact that, you know, we have made so much progress that it is evident to an independent third party that we could be worth billions of dollars one day.
I live in San Francisco, which is obviously the epicenter of AI and innovation that's happening. And yet when I mention or Loyal or dog longevity comes up or Loyal comes up, everyone's eyes light up and it doesn't matter what they're working on, what cool company they're at. The whole conversation shifts to like, oh, tell me more about that. Especially if someone already has a pet or a dog, and that's fun. It's like refreshing. It cuts through the noise in some, in a lot of areas. And that's what makes it so fun and exciting to work on.
My ambitions for longevity do not end with dogs. I think developing drugs to extend dog lifespan is one of the best ways to develop drugs to extend human lifespan. The things that we'll learn from developing a drug that hopefully gives dogs more healthier years is going to teach us so much about how we as humans, you know, we as their protectors who live with them, who share the same environment, who get the same diseases they do, who are exposed to the same things that they are, you know, if we can help a dog live a longer life, it's going to help us understand what can make a human live a longer and healthier life too.